And welcome back to Munich, Germany. We are here on day two of Cellosphere and have an action-packed day of interviews. My name is Savannah Peterson. Very excited to be joined for all of these segments with Rob Strecce. Rob, we're digging Germany.
I love this, and the conversations have been fantastic. And Salonis has really brought a lot of interesting people who are, you know, at the, you know, apex of where the data is meeting the process, being integrated and bringing it all together. So this is a lot of fun.
And we're getting to hear stories of real results and real impacts, which gets me excited, from real brands that everybody knows, which gets me very excited to introduce Tim this morning. Thank you so much for coming to hang out with us.
Thank you for having me.
So you are the largest franchisee of one of the most well-known companies in the world, IKEA. You've got hundreds of retail stores across 30 different countries, over 450, I believe, and I can't wait to hear what you're about to tell us. As we dig in, I can think of so many different use cases for what you're doing and Salonis. How long have you been using the tool?
We started our engagement with Salonis just over 3 years ago, so doing a proof of concept and seeing, right, is there something, can we get something we need which we cannot get in another way? That was the first question. And the answer to that was an undeniable yes. You know, the transparency, the exposure of what's really happening, and to then make sure that we can come to conclusions on that, it was a real game changer for us at that moment in time.
And what were the initial processes that you were hoping to optimize and improve?
We were really looking at the end-to-end of our sales order flow. As a company, our sort of vision statement is creating a better everyday life for the many people. And especially in a post-COVID world, the number of customer interactions coming through our order flow really expanded, really grew very quickly. But it's not the core of what we've been for the last 80 years. We've been a very cash and carry retailer. You come to us, you pick it up, take it home with you. And so this order flow, we wanted to explore it, explain it, understand it, make it better for ourselves and for our customers.
So when you look at it, at your company and how you look at data and process, and because there's a lot of different things that can mean, and in your title is process and data insights, and when I look at that, it can mean so many different things about how you get at those processes, how you get at that data.
Because and it was an interesting job title. I've never been a fan of a job title that contains the word "and." One thing isn't enough, but it's going to be two. But in this case, it was more a way of exploring, because in 2024, what most processes process is data. Now, there are physical components as well, but it's the data representation that is so important. And so what we really wanted to then do is look at data in context of the process. So are we then getting the right data to understand and interrogate and interpret what's going on in our reality? Do we have the transparency, consistency, completeness? But then also, do we really understand exactly what it is that's happening, what's going right, what we want to make better, and then how do we make those things better?
Yeah, I think, so just to follow up on that, when you started down this path with Salonis, you talking to Savannah about, did you have to find that there was different data silos, and was that one of the reasons why you looked to Salonis and to the platform?
Especially when we're looking at sort of such a big, involved, end-to-end process with multiple functions involved, multiple solutions involved, multiple concepts, contexts that we wanted to harmonize and bring together. There was a journey there to actually understand where should the data come from, what does the data mean, how to connect in a good way, because often we're very controlled and very secure within each of those areas, but then it's the leakage when you've got the connections between. And that's something which Salonis and process mining has been sort of game-changing and really differentiating in our ability to be able to interrogate and explore.
When I think about IKEA and optimized experiences, I think about walking through a store, and it's such a journey, right? I mean, it's actually quite representative of the customer journey. And I love when I was looking at our notes in preparation for you, you talk about the perfect order. And I think IKEA has really optimized the perfect walk through the retail experience, but I'm so curious to hear from your perspective as you're thinking about this process, what is the perfect order? What does that look like?
And it's a wonderful parallel, because actually when I was presenting here yesterday, which if anyone would like to, you can watch the video, I actually used the map of the store as an allegory for the story I was telling. For exactly that reason, yes. because that tradition of here's how the store is laid out, here's how best to interact, you're right, we've had that concept for a long time, we're very familiar with it, that's evolved over time. Now, how do we find that parallel when we're not physically meeting the customer, but in a customer not present scenario, and doing exactly that? So we started with a definition from APQC, which is sort of a think tank that we use from a lot of our, you know, definitions and so on, and they got the perfect order. That's what we started with. So yes, taking the order perfectly, delivering the goods on time with the correct tax invoice, all of those components, and just those bits there. Those are four or five different departments you need to bring together to harmonize, to explore and understand. So what we're looking at with a perfect order is, here are the things that we want to happen. That, you know, we get what the customer wants, that there is the payment, that we deliver successfully or we hand over successfully. But then the other side of it is, because you can't really make an order more perfect, but you can prevent it from becoming imperfect. So the thing that we're mostly focusing on right now is, what are the undesirable events, what are the imperfect events, and how do we prevent those from happening? Because eventually, we want to then get to the phrase that I've been using a little bit, is doing the right things whilst doing things right. And at the moment, we're more focused on the first half, so stopping the bad things. And then as we get to a level of maturity there, the things that are left over, we then look to make those efficient, effective, and to improve the experience of those things to be more in line with our store experience.
Yeah, absolutely. So what are some of the, I mean, I can imagine shipping delays and mispacked orders, some of the more obvious things. What are some of the other bad events or negative impacts?
We're being quite binary in our definition at the moment. So, for example, if a customer then changes their mind on when they would like the delivery to occur, at the moment, because we can't always differentiate whether that's because, you know, maybe we've made a mistake and we're reacting to something, or maybe the customer's just had a change of circumstance and, you know, originally I wanted my delivery on Friday, but actually now I need to go and pick the kids up from football practice or something, so now I'd like it on Monday. So at the moment it's the case of, right, how are we making sure we're giving the customers the right options and the right opportunities at the right moment in time so that they can get what they want first time, that we actually meet the promise that we then make them. So yes, when we have changes in items, adding and removing items, did we sell properly in the first place? Changing the services, these kinds of things, because it is really about, right, we form an agreement, we make sure that everyone's happy with it, we deliver on that. The more we can do that, the more efficient and effective we can be, the more consistent we can be.
So I think just playing off that a little bit, and when you start to look across all the processes that you have, and you have a lot of also third parties that you work with, and things of that nature, how far does your process intelligence go? Is it within the franchisee aspect? Does it go up to corporate and things like that, or how far?
At the moment, we haven't gone into the connecting with the franchisor, okay. So it is looking at the retailer.
Yeah.
Now, working with, say, for example, transport service providers, installers, assemblers, the point at which we inform them, this is what needs to happen, and the point at which we get the response, so that request response, we then
add it.
So that we can, because when we're doing that root cause analysis of something that went wrong, maybe the customer wasn't home when we were expecting them to be. Now, was that because we hadn't communicated effectively with the transport service provider? To assist as much as possible in root cause analyzing what went wrong in the first place, what do we then need to fix systematically to make sure it doesn't happen again?
Yeah, that makes sense. And so, obviously, data is kind of the underpinning of process and process intelligence. It's also the underpinning for Gen AI and for everything AI, for that matter.
Yep.
What do you see as initiatives and places you want to go with process and with things like Gen AI?
Yes, but at the moment, we're the sort of stage before Gen AI and looking at more of the machine learning and in the keynote speech yesterday when Divya was presenting the product launches, one of the ones there was called Insights Explorer. We've been co-innovating on that with Thelonis for the last year or so. So when we're talking about, because when you're talking of something as complex as the whole end-to-end of a sales order, you've got how we meet the customer, what they're purchasing, what services, where are we bringing the goods from, how are we getting the goods to them. If you look at all of those different dimensions, and not just the dimensions individually, but the combinations and permutations, if someone were to then ask, what are the big three things we should go after? There are so many possibilities. I have no idea how to brute force analyzing each one. It would just take a long, long time. So by leveraging some of the more advanced analytical techniques, so Insights Explorer, what used to take us an hour to do one analysis, we can now do hundreds of thousands with the click of a mouse. Yeah. And it now tells us of all of the things that are then causing problems with something you're looking to optimize, here are your most important ones. Here's how we really accelerate the time to insight to then fuel time to action and time to value. And then the next stage, I'm going more to the Gen AI,
right,
to then be able to layer over the top of that a large language model and all of these things that for our people in the business to then say, I don't think I'm doing a good enough job in this area. What could I potentially improve? Here's the list. Here's the rationale. Here's what I'm going to go after. And to then democratize the discovery, democratize the analysis closer to the people who can then make a difference utilizing what is found.
You just talked about something that I think a lot of teams can struggle with. Marketing and engineering can have tension here, the C-suite with the rest of the staff. Data-driven prioritization.
Sure.
It can be incredibly hard to figure out what you need to solve first and then figure out what happens next. And it sounds like you're really able to do that as a result of this to end up with this perfect order.
That's what we're certainly moving towards because, I mean, it's not only data-driven, but data-story-driven.
Yeah.
Because data-driven is wonderful when everyone's in a rational frame of mind. But when we also then need to deal with the emotion and we need to deal with the... to be able to then form those into narrative to be able to then say, so then we can connect it to a customer journey. We can then say, imagine this customer purchasing this product that we decide to do in this way, here are the problems it causes. Here are the pain points that if we impact these, this is what we can do better about it. And these kind of ways in which we're using the data to then give that narrative storytelling layer to then be able to infuse people and to then tug at those emotional heartstrings as well, to then really get that change agency and to really get those that movement happening. That's something that we're really looking to accelerate with this new capability, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm curious to hear more about one of the things that's been very inspiring, frankly, about the week is how much Celonis collaborates and works with the many different types of companies across different verticals. What does that collaboration look like? How frequently are you interfacing?
There are three co-innovations that we're working on with Celonis at the moment.
Nice.
One of them we meet weekly, the other two is bi-weekly. So it is a case of, and ultimately it comes down to, we see the need for something within our business. It's something that we then really form that relationship to say, right, how can we produce something that helps you, that we can generalize, that helps everybody? And, you know, given that, as I said earlier, the vision statement of our business is to create a better everyday life for the many people, okay, it's a win-win if we get that connection happening. And then, yeah, it depends on the people that we need to get involved, how technical we're being, bringing those right people together with that right cadence to make sure that we're still building momentum.
Yeah.
That's something that's also really, really important for us to maintain.
How do you see this process optimization and process intelligence really helping drive towards corporate goals like sustainability? And how is that really factoring in? Because that's been one of the most fun topics that we've been talking about. We all have to be, you know, focused on it. So, but how is that kind of helping?
With all of the use cases that we come up with all the explorations that we do, we look to understand them with the triple line perspective, top line, bottom line, green line. And especially when we're talking about, you know, there's the impact on the planet of most of our products are made of wood. We're trying to move the products. There's CO2 emissions involved in transportation, these kinds of things. So being able to then, and once again, actually comes back to that whole thing of data-driven storytelling. If we've then got those different perspectives to also say, these are the amount of CO2 emissions in this. When this thing goes wrong, not only is it costing us this much money or having this impact on customer satisfaction, but also it's having this environmental impact. It just gives that more rounded picture, that more complete picture, to then make sure that we're really understanding all of the impact of what it is that we're talking about. So, yes, sustainability, in fact, that's not weekly or bi-weekly, that's the monthly session that we have with our sustainability team, with the apps that we're then putting together, with returns, for example. I mean, we don't like returning, having returns come back. Customers don't like having to return things. the planet doesn't like us having to go and pick things up and bring them back to our stores and so on. So finding those synergies, because it's not a net zero sum game, right? It's a 1+1=3. When we are able to find these synergies, everyone benefits from it.
And benefits in a lot of different ways, too, not just from the frustration. Yeah. All right, I got to ask, so are you an absolute pro at building IKEA furniture?
I'm an enthusiastic amateur.
Yeah.
I think professional is maybe a step too far. One of my brothers used to be in the stores where you've got the checkouts, you've got Bargain Corner, or our Circular Hub, as it's now called. One of my brothers used to be the manager of that area. So when he's like putting together some furniture and stuff, he's an absolute wizard at it. I can do it. I'm capable of it. But there are better.
Yes. You call your brother.
Which was a bit of a challenge after I moved country, but I still tried that. But fortunately, even to the relatively uninitiated, it's easy enough to do.
So, Tim, you've got so many different initiatives going on. It's really cool to hear about all the different innovation projects. You've been working with Celonis for 3 years, as you mentioned. When we have you on the show at next year's Celestine, what do you have to be able to say then that you can't yet say today?
I think that the one thing that I would really love for us to be able to have, because right now we have perfect order performance, as you called out there. I would love there to be a suite of perfect performance scores, not just related to orders, but then related to invoices, related to month-end closing, related to customer service, related to... Because the thing that's been so fantastic about the perfect order performance is that it's been this rallying call to lots of different functions to come together with a unified goal. And that in itself, of just having a common language and a way to interact with each other, has been so beneficial. And so to be able to actually deliver that and leverage that in other areas, that's the one thing I would love to see, is that I actually then have my perfect performance dashboard with all of the perfect performance scores. That's what I would love to be able to deliver over the course of this next year. And we're really looking in accounts payable and stores to pay around the invoicing, month-end closing, that's going to be a big area. I'd like to be getting, we're at 1 at the moment, get to 3 or 5 by this time next year, and then it's the start of a beautiful thing.
Well, this has been a perfect discussion. We look forward to talking about more perfection across the business with you next time. Tim, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you.
And thank you, Rob, for hanging out. I feel like we're going to go to IKEA after this.
I don't know about you, but I love walking.
If you didn't bring up the meatballs,
my wife's Swedish.
I'm sort of turning into one.
I don't know about that. On that, thank you, Beth, and thank all of you for tuning in to this fabulous segment here in Munich, Germany. We're at Celonis Celesphere. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.